What can we do to get lawyers and the pro se litigants to spend the time to research things thoroughly and then to focus their briefs on the issues that count?
It's tough to find the time, never mind the patience, to locate the one or two good arguments buried in a pile of weak arguments.
It's not just a matter of investment of time. It's a failure to prepare. It's a failure to read the rules.
Preparing a brief for the Court of Appeals is not an easy task. Careful attention to the rules of court and hard work are essential for success. Our individual caseloads have more than doubled over the past 10 years and continue to increase every year. This is why we must emphasize the need for you to do your part in writing your brief and preparing your oral argument. This videotape should help you to understand what we feel are the essential elements to a brief. We hope you enjoy it, and we look forward to your appeal.
You're familiar with age discrimination claims under the ADEA?
Well, somewhat. In law school, I prepared this law review article.
Well, Joseph, here are the facts. An unhappy employee sued our client, Angelo Basilico. The employee argued he was fired because of his age. We lost in district court. If the judgment stands, Mr. Basilico is in danger of losing his business, so he wants to appeal.
Do we have a chance?
Maybe.
Miss Alvarez, so good to see you.
Mr. Basilico, this is my associate, Joseph Harris.
Nice to meet you, Mr. Harris.
Joseph, please.
Joseph is going to prepare the brief for the appeal, under my supervision, of course.
Your motion for a new trial was filed, but denied a few days ago. So I'm planning to file the actual notice of appeal tomorrow.
Angelo, before we actually file the notice, I want to make sure you really want to appeal. It's not cheap. The process takes a long time, and the chances of winning any appeal are never great.
Miss Alvarez, if the decision of the court stands, I'll lose everything. Joseph here will do his best job, and maybe you can save what I have worked so hard for.
Let's hope so.
What can I do to help?
Not much right now, but we'll consult with you at every step along the way. As we discussed, we already filed a motion to stay the judgment. After Joseph files a notice of appeal, he'll prepare and file the brief. If the court needs more explanation to decide the issues, it will schedule an oral argument in front of a three-judge panel and hear from the lawyers on each side before making a decision. This whole process can take a long time.
Then let's get started.
You okay? You look nervous.
I'm fine.
I know you're new to our firm, but this isn't the first appellate brief you've ever written, is it?
Oh, in my last firm, I did some state court appellate work, but never anything for the Ninth Circuit.
Don't worry. You'll do just fine. I got a few pointers.
You always do.
First, get the federal rules of appellate procedure and the Ninth Circuit rules and read them. They have all the basic procedural information you'll need.
Federal rules and circuit rules. Okay, got it.
Be careful when assembling your file. Don't assume you have copies of all the documents filed in district court. Compare your file with the district court's computer-generated docket sheet. Then you'll know what to order. You are responsible for ordering all the transcripts you'll need.
Getting files together and ordering transcripts.
Next, do complete and thorough research. Oh, and don't forget about deadlines. You've got to calendar them all. Some are jurisdictional and could inhibit or even bar the appeal.
Well, that would be bad.
Not to mention malpractice.
Calendar all deadlines.
If you fail to file a notice of appeal on time, you're out. And that's your first deadline after the district court's entry of judgment.
Notice of appeal. First thing tomorrow.
Good morning. How may I help you?
I'd like to file a notice of appeal.
Well, first of all, this is the wrong court.
The wrong court? Don't the briefs get filed here?
Yes, but it's the district court where you file the notice of appeal, and you could have simply dropped it in the mail.
I'm sorry. This is my first time handling an appeal before the Ninth Circuit.
It's okay. I'll forward it. You know, sometimes when you're close to a deadline, it's not a bad idea to hand deliver your documents.
Just to the right court.
Right. Here, take a look at this. This is a docketing package. It's published by the court and contains much of the basic procedural information, like when to file the notice of appeal, how to order transcripts, fees for transcripts, designation of the record.
Thank you.
And I assume you have a copy of FRAP? The Federal Rules of Appellate Procedure?
At the firm, yes, we have that at the firm.
They're essential. Also, you'll need to review the local circuit rules. Certain procedures apply to some circuits, but not others.
So, district court for the notice of appeal, docket package, federal rules, circuit rules. Anything else?
Just give yourself plenty of time to write the brief. Good luck.
Thanks. I'll need it. Nora, you got a minute? Let me read this to you. Something's wrong.
I'm listening.
The appellant herein reiterates its position, to wit, that the livelihood of the appellant will be severely infringed should the judgment for the appellee subsequently stand without remedy from the higher court, which is imperative.
Is that the end of the sentence?
What do you mean?
I didn't understand a thing you said.
The appellant herein reiterates its position, to wit...
Come on. I'm pregnant. I'm not hard of hearing.
Well, so what's the problem?
I can't understand what you're saying.
That's because you don't understand the case.
No, it's not. What's all this to wit and herein and subsequent to stuff?
That's the way lawyers write.
Well, it's hard to understand. You should use shorter sentences and more comprehensible language.
You don't know what you're talking about. If you were more familiar with the case, you'd understand what I'm saying.
Who's supposed to read this brief when you're done?
Well, the judges, the clerks, other lawyers.
And these judges and clerks, will they be familiar with the case before they read this?
Well, no, but...
Cut to the chase. Simplify your word choice. Use shorter sentences without all that legalese. Hey, you're smart. You don't need to impress them with phrases like heretofore and... What was that other one?
To wit. I love that expression.
Dump it. Now, whitherest doth thou go to bed?
I get the point.
You don't stay up too late, okay?
You wanted to see me?
Good morning, Joseph. Have a seat. I read your brief in Simmons versus Basilico yesterday.
And?
Well, my first impression was, wow, looked like our case was a slam dunk, an easy reversal. Too easy. I didn't remember the facts as being so one-sided in our favor. So I took some time and I reviewed the record below, and I was right. You didn't tell the full story in your statement of facts.
But all I was trying to do was...
Every appellate judge would see through this. You can't avoid bad facts by just omitting them. This needs a lot of work.
Part of the problem was there was such a poor record made below.
You can't use that as an excuse. You're stuck with the record below.
Fine, but some of the evidence in the trial cut against us.
Joseph, don't be afraid to tell the other side of the story, the case against you. You can bolster your credibility by facing up to the facts. If you duck the hard stuff, the court will know it, and your opponent will certainly emphasize it in his responding brief.
So how do you handle the bad facts?
By surrounding them with good facts and explanation.
Sounds a bit tricky.
It's not really. Overall, your brief should concentrate on the one or two points of law that we really feel are essential to our case. We don't have to elaborate on everything that happened below, only on those things related to the issues. Focus is the key.
All right. I'll try that.
Okay. Now some specifics. You've got to weed through and order your arguments. Lead with your strongest argument first. Also, don't waste your introductory sentences. Try to summarize in two or three succinct sentences why we should win. Oh, and sometimes you fail to cite controlling precedent. Can't do that. Only rely on outside authority when the issue hasn't been addressed in this circuit. And what about critical exhibits, like the letter of employment? Use the trial exhibits to prove your points. Quote from them, refer to them, integrate them into your argument. Overall, this was too vague and unsubstantiated.
Sorry about that.
Don't apologize.
Just get it right next time.
So when do you want to see next time?
Well, I'm calling the client on Friday, so I'll need it by the end of the week.
This is going to take a lot more time than I thought.
Welcome to the world of appellate practice, Mr. Harris.
What about an extension?
Well, it's not something the parties can just agree to.
What's the procedure?
If it's at least a week before the brief's due date, and you've never asked for a continuance before, you can get a short extension by telephoning the clerk of court. For longer extensions, you've got to file a motion. They're harder to get. If you want a second continuance or extension, you can think again. But let's try to get this in on time. Extensions don't look good, especially since we're the appellant.
Okay. I'll get right on it.
And Joseph, I'll need to see your excerpt of record.
My what?
Today is your lucky day, class. I won't be lecturing. No, instead, we have a guest lecturer. Judge Thomas Nelson from the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals will be discussing a topic that most appellate advocacy classes forget to cover. Excerpts of record. Judge Nelson?
Thank you for inviting me. Let me start out by saying that preparing the excerpts of record is one of the most difficult parts of the appellate process. The excerpt consists of selections from the record and exhibits which support your claim. It's difficult because, for one thing, the rules for compiling the excerpt periodically change. So when it's your turn to prepare an excerpt, make sure that you consult the most current guidelines. Some documents are required, like the notice of appeal and the district court docket. Other items are optional. The key is you've got to include in the excerpt all cites to the record which are found in the brief. So, to include or not to include, that is the question. Here's my rule of thumb. Let the record speak for you. Put in the important things that make your case. If it's a contract case, put in the contract. Why do people omit the obvious? Make sure that you include all pages of the reporter's transcript where the ruling or instruction is found. And be sure to include a page or two before and after to give context to your factual assertions. Remember, you're preparing the excerpt for those of us who did not attend the trial. So if you think we'll be confused by a statement or an assertion, give us the history. Don't leave us guessing. If you make a statement of fact and it's not supported in the record, the court may assume that you are twisting or manipulating the facts to support your contentions. We don't appreciate that. Also, select carefully from the motions filed in the district court. Don't just put them all in the excerpt. Nelson's golden rule, only put in those portions of documents that are cited in the brief or which are necessary for resolution of an issue on appeal. Now a few specifics. Include a table of contents in the excerpt. We want to know what's in there. Also, make sure you include the pertinent parts of trial exhibits and declarations from motions. Make a note of the trial court's exhibit number when you refer to it in the brief. And remember your page limits per volume. You can have as long an excerpt as you need, but each individual volume is limited to 300 pages. And docket sheet should be the last document in the excerpt before the certificate of service.
Why do we need to include docket sheets?
Good question, because we can, in a glance, get a sense of what happened in the district court in chronological order. We will know what motions to look for in the district court record.
I have a more basic question. Why do we need to prepare an excerpt at all? The appellate court has the district court's file, right? Why not just photocopy the whole file? That way nobody can be accused of forgetting anything or leaving something out.
There are many documents in the district court record which have nothing to do with the issues on appeal. Besides, I'd like to see you travel the largest federal circuit by plane, covering 9 states, with the entire record from 30 cases. I'm in good shape, but not that good a shape.
This is more like it. Concise, with a nicely organized excerpt. Just don't be late filing it.
Consider it filed. Hi.
Hello.
I want to file this brief.
You didn't need to bring it here in person. You could have simply mailed it in. That's right. just so it's postmarked by the due date. I remember you. You know, it's not really necessary for you to keep coming here in person. We encourage mailing.
I know. I just wanted to. I spent so much time working on this.
That's okay.
Do you have any idea when this will be scheduled for oral argument?
The court will send you a notice about a month before the date.
Not me, the senior partner. She'll be arguing it.
Well, put her name on the form. But remember, sometimes there is no oral presentation if the court deems it submitted on the brief.
Got it.
They did a good job with their brief. Two strong arguments on why the judgment should be affirmed. Good one-page argument summary. They responded to your arguments in order, short and to the point. Simmons's testimony alone constitutes sufficient evidence to sustain the trial court's findings that he was fired because of his age. The fact that Simmons was Basilico's only older employee confirms that the finding of age discrimination was not clearly erroneous. If I didn't know the case for us, I'd say it didn't look too good for Mr. Basilico.
So what's our strategy for the reply?
We want to make sure that our reply brief makes it clear that Simmons's brief doesn't tell the whole story. And we should do this without merely restating the same facts and arguments that we brought out in our opening brief. We want to counter the appellee's arguments with short, succinct responses. Let's talk about the terms of the contract and the inadmissible hearsay testimony by Mrs. Simmons to refocus the court's attention. There was no evidence of age discrimination. Limit it to that. But don't bring up anything outside the record or new arguments for reversal.
You mean don't sandbag your opponent?
Very unprofessional. But if the appellee has done too much damage, you can sometimes shift the focus in the reply brief from one argument to another.
Got it.
And don't forget to shepherdize just before the argument. If you find anything, you'll have to file a 28J letter.
You better call Nora and tell her she'll be eating dinner alone tonight.
Joseph, you're doing a great job. Keep it up. Joseph, just got the notice for oral argument on the Basilico case. I'm going to be out of town with Gendron versus Idaho, so I want you to handle it.
What, me?
I've already contacted Mr. Basilico, and he's agreed with my decision.
I appreciate your faith in me, but I really think...
Look, you know the record and the arguments better than I do. Don't worry. I'm an excellent coach. It pays to be adjunct faculty. Stand behind the podium, counselor. One suggestion I have for you is to prepare an argument book.
An argument book?
Put all your answers to anticipated tough questions, all your citations to the record, copies of the case summaries, along with citations to relevant cases in a notebook. Have it ready to go before your court date. Okay, you look nervous. Don't be. In a clear, strong voice, I want to hear you address me as you would the judges of the Ninth Circuit. No reading. Be persuasive and succinct. And don't forget about making eye contact with the judges. Very important.
The appellant has been severely damaged due to the actions of the court below, which failed to instruct on the requisite prerequisites of contract law, and further failed to rule pretrial on the proper parameters of this course of action.
It's not a race, Mr. Harris. Slow down. And use plain English. You're not impressing anyone, sounding like what we think a lawyer sounds like. Instead, start with a 2 to 4 minute summary of your argument. Let them know where you're going with your presentation. Go on.
There was no evidence of age bias, as appellee claims. Clearly, it is maladroit posturing on the part of the appellee.
I'm sorry to interrupt again. There's no need to get hostile. Keep your level of indignation down. The judges haven't lived with this case as long as you have. Secondly, don't keep using words like appellant and appellee. Use terms that help amplify the point, like Mr. Basilico and the employee. Let's hear some more.
Mr. Basilico employed Mr. Simmons in the fruit department for 12 years. They had a good relationship. It wasn't until the employee wanted to buy a competitor's store nearby that problems began.
Good.
I like that.
Simmons's work performance began to suffer. He started coming in late, leaving early, and taking long lunches. Mr. Basilico soon learned that the reason for the change in Mr. Simmons' work habits was that he was trying to become a competitor to Angelo's market. He started using his work time to copy suppliers' lists and sales procedure memos in anticipation of owning his own store. It was for that reason that he was let go and not for the reasons that Mr. Simmons claims.
Excuse me, I have a question. What about the age discrimination claim? Mr. Simmons says he was fired for that reason, and the jury apparently agreed, so what about it? You have to be ready for the tough questions.
The jury was influenced by the improper testimony of Mr. Simmons' wife. The court erred in admitting irrelevant evidence of Simmons' wife's fatal illness. This prejudiced the jury. They should have never heard of her illness. Anyone would have felt sorry and awarded money. A proper ADEA case is one where there is evidence of discrimination based on improper grounds. None existed here. Rather, Simmons's work performance deteriorated as he tried to become a competitor by opening his own discount fruit supply mart.
But the jury found for Simmons. Shouldn't we defer to them?
They did find for Simmons, but they were prejudiced by the improper admission of the health problems of Simmons's wife, as evidenced in the excerpt of record at page 17, paragraph 2. The admission of this evidence was highly prejudicial, and since it was, as the record shows, the main evidence for the jury's verdict, without it, there could have been no finding for Mr. Simmons. Finally, the instruction defining bias was erroneous as a matter of law. Since this was a crucial element for the plaintiff's claim and an explanatory instruction, the abuse of discretion standard does not apply. Therefore, you can reverse the judgment below as a matter of law and are not required to defer to the jury's findings.
Let's review. Discuss with the client. Get and read the rules, FRAP and Ninth Circuit. Order the reporter's transcripts. Calendar all deadlines. File timely the notice of appeal in district court. Read the docketing package. It contains useful information on the appellate process. Allow plenty of time to write the brief. Extensions of time are not favored. Use shorter sentences and more comprehensible language. Remember your audience. Simplify your word choice. Avoid legalese. You can't avoid bad facts by omitting them. Rather, surround bad facts with good facts and explanation. You're bound by the record below. Concentrate on one or two points of law that are essential to the case. Focus is key. Lead with your strongest argument. Be sure to cite controlling precedent, even if it is against your position. Use critical exhibits to prove your point. Make sure you have the most current rules. Some items in the excerpts are mandatory. Include pages of the reporter's transcript where the ruling or instruction at issue is found. Golden rule. Put in all of those portions of documents that are cited in your brief or which are necessary for resolution of an issue on appeal. Include a table of contents. Each volume of the excerpts should contain no more than 300 pages. The district court docket sheet should be the last document in your excerpt. Consult with your client before filing the brief. It can be mailed in and must be postmarked by the due date. Maintain the same order of arguments as used in the appellant's opening brief. Meet appellant's arguments squarely. Keep your brief short and to the point. Don't just restate your opening brief. Use short, succinct arguments to counter appellee's arguments. Don't bring up anything outside the record. Don't sandbag. Shepherdize before oral argument. If new authority is found, send a FRAP 28J letter. Prepare an argument book that includes an outline of main points you plan to make, answers to anticipated tough questions, citations to the record, copies or summaries of key cases. Use a clear, strong voice. No reading. Be persuasive and succinct. Make eye contact. Slow down. Use plain English. Let them know where you are going. Start with a 2 to 4 minute summary of your argument. Don't get hostile about trial judge or opposing counsel. Respond directly to questions.